Benjamin, everybody.
Hi, Benjamin. Thanks. Thanks for having me here, Nayana. Thanks for inviting me to give the limited things that I know about WebAssembly. Okay, so as what the speaker mentioned, that it'll be very heavy on JavaScript and the backend. I know this CSS is more of a front-end one, but please just bear with me for 10 minutes, just 10 minutes. You can sleep or anything. Yeah, the recording is on me, it's not on you. Yeah, so when we talk about WebAssembly, we have to first understand about JavaScript, because WebAssembly is another language to complement JavaScript. So when we talk about JavaScript, let's talk about the history of JavaScript. When JavaScript was first introduced, it was interpreted by the browsers. It wasn't a compiled language. So when we interpret it, it means it translates to the machine code line by line. So that works very well for small applications, because you first start the first line, you translate it, and you can just keep going on. It's easy for developers because they don't have to do any compilation. You just write a JavaScript and just execute in the browser, right? But because JavaScript was picking up at that time, so people start to develop bigger and bigger apps. But as they develop bigger and bigger apps, you imagine if you add in more code, you definitely add in like loops, for loops, while loops, nested loops, and such like that. So when you add in all these loops, the translation works very hard, because it has to go through again, because it doesn't compile, so it doesn't have the code there. So it goes through the code again, and it goes again and again, the same code again and again and again. So that's how the JavaScript interpreter code so-called died for a few years, because people thought that it couldn't go any further. That was the limit of JavaScript, right? That was until the next phase, where there was this just-in-time compilers. Just-in-time compilers is, so now you actually compile the JavaScript code into binary code to execute in the browsers, right? So because executing compiled codes are much faster, the performance of the JavaScript applications start to get faster, right? So things like Node.js, server-side scripting all comes into play, right? So but due to the nature of JavaScript, because JavaScript is a dynamic and weakly typed language, there is a limit to how much JIT can help to improve the performance, right? So let's say, for example, if we have this function here, it's a very simple function that everyone could know, right? But you might not know, because x plus 1, it can be anything. If x, you give it 5, return you 6. If x, you give it a string, it will give you string plus 1. So the compiler doesn't know what it is at the point of time where it reads it. Only during runtime, when you pass in a value, the compiler knows that it's an integer or it's a string, then it will do compilation, right? So the reason why just-in-time is slow, because when you go through this piece of code, it actually has to compile different variations of the code. And if they reach this code and they say, oh, this is not a string, I need to throw this away, and I'll take the next one, which is the integer. Yeah, and this is what just-in-time, this is the limitation of just-in-time. But just imagine what happens if we could know this type beforehand. So if I give you JavaScript functions like this, this is a bitwise operation. So if you know bitwise operation, you can only perform bitwise operation on integers. So what this means is that the x bitwise operation, if it's 0, the x will definitely be an integer. The return value is an integer as well. So if the compiler looks at this chunk of code, it knows that, okay, you are doing a integer addition. So it doesn't need to know during runtime that whether is it a string or an integer. So if the compiler knows it's an integer beforehand, it can just do a compilation before it even executes it. That is called ahead of time compiler. Yeah. And this ahead of time compiler is what ASM or ASM, it's known to be called ASM, I don't know why. ASM, how it performs much better than JavaScript. Right. So you cannot directly compile JavaScript to ASM due to the fact that JavaScript is a weakly type, the compiler also doesn't know it until it reaches that point. This code is actually compiled from C++ or C code. Right. So that is what ASM gives us as well. We can directly High five? Oh, okay. you can directly translate our code, with existing code, application code, into JavaScript. So they say Asm, this code, it looks like JavaScript, yet it doesn't look like the standard JavaScript. So that's why they call it subset of JavaScript. So things like Mozilla Firefox, because they were the owners of the whole Asm language, they optimized their engine, JavaScript, the SpiderMonkey engine, to actually perform very well on Asm code. That's why it's called a subset of JavaScript. But this piece of code, you can actually run it in browsers as well, even without any optimizations from Mozilla or VA engine. As long as the engine can read JavaScript, we can run this piece of code. Okay. So, but when we talk about Asm, it also compiles just in time. So that means when you reach the code, then it starts to compile, right? That is also a bit of an overhead. Furthermore, because Asm is JavaScript, it actually goes through the parsing, the compilation to bytecode binary before it gets decoded into machine code. What if we could actually compile it beforehand and directly pass the engine the binary? We will cut down on the whole first part of the compiling from the source code to the binary, right? So that is what Wasm gives us. Okay. I don't have a slide for that. Okay, yeah. So that's what Wasm gives us. So Wasm gives us directly the bytecode language that we can just put into the VA engine or the SpiderMonkey engine. It's because it's a binary and not a text file, it's much smaller. So that improves the application load time as well. Yeah. And because it's a machine language rather than text, it actually performs operations faster than Asm actually does. Right. There are a few more other optimizations that Wasm gives us, but that is a separate topic altogether. So the next one will be where we can use Wasm's, right? Or WebAssembly. So WebAssembly will be good for high performance apps like video games, like CAD design, computer aided designs, like video and imaging and image editing, or data visualization. Okay. I don't see why in the future we can't expect email services or even word processing to be on Wasm. They are currently not on yet now, not on that now, because Wasm is relatively new technology. As well as CPU intensive calculations like face detections, like compression algorithms, and all this we can make use of WebAssembly to perform. And because WebAssembly runs entirely on the web platform without any plugins, we can just integrate them into our existing apps quite easily. Right. So I have this one final slide where it's just a short video on what the Unity is, a game engine. They have converted their code into Wasm, and you can really run them in Mozilla. Yeah, so you see the gameplay might not be 60 frames per second, it might not be the quickest you have seen, but it's good enough for you to have a smooth gameplay on the web. Skip all the advertisements. So with that, I thank you for bearing with me.